tiny village of just 600 people is about to be invaded by over 3,500 who've come from United Reformed chapels all over Britain to celebrate the opening of a brand new National Youth Centre. So as you can see, rehearsals are well underway. So welcome to Yardley Hastings. Been pouring into the village over this bridge since midday, and as you can see, they are still coming. There's a great air of excitement, and the whole village has really taken on a carnival atmosphere.
Quite a lot of Fury members are dressed as clowns as well, just to bring notice to the fact that Fury are here and are alive, and we like to be a bit different. Fury is the Fellowship United Reformed Youth, which is people from the age groups 14 to 25.
Where have you all come from today?
We're from Abbots Road United Reformed Church in Leicester!
And why did you decide to come along?
Mainly to get a flavour of what the actual centre is like, because we haven't seen it as yet, because it's just opening today. And so we've got a lot of these youngsters here with us, who hopefully in the future will be coming along to this Yardley Hastings and enjoying all the fun and activity that goes on down there.
We got up at 6 o'clock this morning. There you go. So we're very tired.
We've always wanted a centre. Now we've got it. And we want to come and support it and wish it well.
Where have you come from today?
We've come from Sleaford in Lincolnshire.
Coventry.
United.
Derby.
Hartlepool.
Northampton.
Welcome to Yardley Hastings!
Almost the entire congregation during the last few years at the old chapel. Laurie, what were those services like with so few of you rattling around in there?
Well, there weren't even as many as there are here now. There were about half as many. We were down to about 8 or 9.
Were you all very worried at that time that perhaps the services had stopped completely?
No, we never thought of closure. We didn't know what the future held, but we felt sure that with this tremendous past, there was no way that it could all end and just fade away into the mists of time.
So what were your initial reactions when you heard of the plans for the new chapel?
A tremendous feeling of relief, because we'd been carrying out what I can best describe as a holding operation for many years, perhaps 10 years or so.
And now that it's here and it's all finished, what do you think of it?
I think it's wonderful.
It was really marvellous to see it develop. And to come as it is now, well, it surpassed all our expectations, I think.
You've just arrived in the village very recently, so what do you think of the chapel?
I think the wonderful thing when we arrived in August was the feeling of excitement amongst the folks who've been here for so many years. It wasn't as if they were giving something away. It was as if they were, you know, having new life.
You've got 2 young children, so I mean, do you think that they'll benefit a great deal from it as well?
We hope so.
Yeah.
And obviously they'll benefit from all the various styles of worship that they will be experiencing in the centre.
Are the styles of worship going to be very different from the ones you would have had at the old chapel?
Yes.
Here it is, all finished. But you were the one really with the initial idea, so where did it come from?
It's a response to a whole series of issues that affected URC youth work. And in the summer of 1987, I was able to find space and time to think about all these issues, and they all came together in what we have here.
What was your initial vision for the centre?
Based here, we had a project called the Ginger Group Project.
What were the Ginger Groups?
The Ginger Group Project drew together groups of young people, half a dozen of them at a time, who lived here in the old manse in Yardley Hastings, as a base, and from there they went out and worked in churches all over the country for up to a fortnight at a time, involved in community projects, evangelism, and very interesting, exciting ideas.
So this really is a follow-on from that?
Yes, the important part of it is the involvement of young people in terms of their contributions that they can make in leadership and to the life of the church, and yes, it has grown out of that.
When people come here and stay, the youth groups in particular, what will they be doing?
A whole wide range of programs, projects, outward bound activities, Bible studies, discussion, theme groups, dance, drama, you name it, it'll all take place in there.
Absolutely, everything. When young people come and stay here, what sort of changes do you see taking place within them?
They're going to find out a lot about themselves, what they believe, what they think and feel about the world they're part of, and they'll be encouraged to find ways of making a contribution to the life of the church, and more importantly to the life of the society as young Christians.
How do you feel today standing here in front of it with it all completed?
Delighted, absolutely thrilled. I mean, it's surpassed all my expectations. You sit and look at plans and you see the plans, but when you see it in real, it's just brilliant.
We're standing in the newly refurbished chapel in the centre, and with me is the Reverend Liz Byrne, who was one of the members of the original Ginger group to be based here before all the changes took place. Liz, it must have been very different then.
Yes, it was. I mean, it was a very old house, quite run down in many ways. It's funny, last night I was thinking about how it used to be, and in some ways they've lost some of the original quirks of the building, and yet if you look in cupboards and things, you can find them. It's quite amazing how the place has changed, and yet they have in many ways kept part of the character.
What was it like living in a community?
It wasn't easy. There were good times and we enjoyed ourselves, but it was difficult with six different people coming from quite different backgrounds, living together and working together.
And do you think, looking back on it, that it was good training for the ministry?
Definitely. It was good to be able to see so many churches. During our year, we visited 52 different churches in the URC, and I could never have done that in any other way. And also learning different ways of working with young people, of leading church meetings, holiday clubs. We did so many things that I know I'll be able to use in my ministry.
Now, over the years to come, there will be many, many more young people following in your footsteps. What would your advice be to them?
I think to be themselves. I think that's one of the main things. That's pointless trying to be one of the volunteers that's come before them. They've got to be themselves. They've got so much to offer. They themselves have got their own experiences, and they can offer that to both the Resource Centre and to Fury nationwide.
Be grown in you and you in me.
age did you both get involved with the chapel?
Well, my involvement goes back several years when I was asked to look at the building in its rather decaying state and advise on the woodworm and so on and see what could be done with it. And my answer was, you can't do anything with it other than change the lot. And that's really how the vision of the centre came into being.
And Maurice, what were the particular challenges from your point of view?
Well, it's a building which spans from the end of the 17th century right through to the end of the 19th. And a huge floor area, 4,000 square feet, a listed building, which meant it couldn't be demolished. And there's a small congregation here worshipping in this huge place. And the challenge really was to try and convert that large floor area, add to it if we can, so that it would be a youth centre with conference accommodation and also sleeping accommodation and canteen, also everything for a conference centre.
Let's go and have a look inside.
Yes, right.
Sure.
Now, it's a very old house, so did you have to keep anything in particular?
Well, this staircase we're going up now dates from the original house, and as you can see, it doesn't actually meet the present-day building regulation requirements, but we have to keep it, and I think it's a good job that we did, because it's part of the original character of the building.
So what did you have to do in this part of the house?
Well, we're now on the top floor in the attic, and you
can see...
You're a
bit too tall for him,
or... I'm not really designed for this sort of building.
There are sandbars being short.
And here, as you can see in here, we've really created a room out of an old attic room, keeping a lot of the old beams and creating some light from the ceiling.
What part of the building are we in at the moment?
Well, we are in fact in the upper part of the old chapel, which if you can imagine was a large room with galleries on three sides, holding 600 or 700 people. And so there's been a new floor put in halfway up, and we're standing on that.
And wasn't there an enormous pulpit which was downstairs as well?
There was it's a good story actually. There was a pulpit, a Victorian pulpit at the end, which we tried to get removed, but we couldn't get planning permission. And the pulpit was left there through almost the whole of the building operation until we actually won an appeal with the DOE to have it removed.
There's a fabulous crucifix behind you on the wall. Has that got any special significance?
That was part of the old roof timbers that were eaten by the Death Watch beetle and so on. Two were retrieved from the skip, and a cross has been made of it, and that really is a sign for the future.
What are your hopes for the future for the building?
To be bursting at the seams. It's like all these old church buildings that had life put into them. To actually see them bursting at the seams with life, and particularly in this case with youth, is just wonderful.
Thank you. you remember how homesick you're feeling, and after the first week, I've been alright.
Alex, what are you hoping to get out of it?
I'm hoping to try things I've never tried before. That is one thing, and I really want to be challenged to do these things. I'm quite scared by the prospect of doing some of them, but I want to take advantage of the time and actually get them done.
I'd like to work in the church eventually, though. In what way, I'm not quite sure, but this is, for me, exploring my faith and what I personally believe.
What about the rest of you? Why did you come?
No, I thought I knew before I came here. I thought I had it all mapped out, but since I come here, I've not been sure. I've always been interested in working with people and young people especially, but obviously there's quite a few years before I can really get into youth work, so I don't know now. I think I'm just going to take some time out afterwards to explore it again.
So you will have groups coming along. What sort of age groups will they be?
There'll be 11 to 14 groups, and then older, up to 25. But the centre's not just for Christian or youth groups, it's for anybody who wants to use it.
We're just there to assist them in any way that they want. It might be just making drinks or running the tuck shop, but it might be helping run a session or organise a treasure hunt or something like that. Anything can happen.
The Yardley Hastings team hope and pray that this centre and the Fury project will encourage the sharing of resources.
The URC has over 161,000 members, and many are hungry for the bread of life.
Who has bread?
Great difficulty, I think. The pressure is going to be from both camps to on my time and on my energies and on my resources. I'm here primarily as the chaplain of the new resource centre, but also I have a small congregation that I have to offer pastoral oversight to, and over the next few months that whole role will evolve for me.
What kind of effect do you think the centre will have on the village?
It's already had an amazing effect. It's engendered a great deal of enthusiasm from the local villagers. It's also brought that sort of elusive quality that youth brings to any environment. Like most villages, there are a large number now of elderly or middle-aged people who are wondering what the future of the village holds. And although there's no industry here for young people, the very presence of young people adds that certain dimension which has brought the place alive again.
How will the Yardley Hastings Centre differ from other similar projects?
Mainly from the fact that we have a live-in community of young people who will offer this peer group and an identity group that our visiting young people can reach out to and be reached out to. Also by the fact that the centre is here not just for young people, it's also here for the whole of the local church in every area of the country. And so someone has already given us an analogy that the Yardley Hastings Centre is rather like a heart pumping the life's blood into the local churches. It's not just here for its own sake.
Are you very optimistic about the future?
I'm very optimistic about the future. We already have inquiries and bookings right up to 1994, and we've had inquiries from Australia even. So it's marvellous how this small village and this small centre has already reached out in such an amazing way.
You'll never have a spare bed.
I hope not.
Why have the church and people like yourself put so much energy and money and work into the youth?
Because we believe in them. A lot of people say the youth are the church of tomorrow. We don't believe that. They are obviously going to be the church of tomorrow, but they're the church of today. They have a say today, they have a voice today, and they have an enormous number of talents and gifts that need to be engendered and encouraged and built up in order for them to be the best disciples they can be in the future.
People meet with you, the living God, during their time here. We pray for those who will lead worship, whether by word, music, drama, dance, or song. May your Spirit give them sensitivity and guidance as they enable your people to worship.
Let us go now as spirited people. Be builders of understanding and makers of peace.
Shine on me.
Well, we've had a wonderful day here in Yardley Hastings. It's been good food, good fun, and some great singing. And we wish the Youth Resource Centre and everybody involved with it all the best for the future. I'm sure it's going to be a great success. Join us again next week when Pam Rhodes will be at the seafront at Loo in Cornwall. Until then, goodbye.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lynn Redgrave.
Thank you so much. Thank you. How many of you are Neighbours fans? Well, my star guest tonight is best known as one of the original residents of Ramsey Street, and the place simply wouldn't be the same without her. She is that glamorous gran, Helen Daniels, whose story has unfolded through good times and bad ever since the series started 7 years ago.
I guess you kind of heard I got kicked out of Arlenwood.
Oh, yes, I heard.
You're mad, huh?
I would be if I were not so pleased to see you.
As I expect you all know, Helen is played by that fine actress Anne Haddie, and as we shall discover, her real-life story rivals almost anything that's ever happened to the fictional characters in Ramsey Street. For Anne...
It's me!
Romance and laughter in Cousins.